It's International Women's Day, March the 8th, 2017, and Strike4Repeal is taking place in Dublin. I'd headed into the city early because a little bird had told me of plans to cover up and alter some of the Dublin statues. While at the Molly Malone statue, I explained to a couple of American tourists what the day was about.
That's something I'm not.
Do you know what it means?
No.
No, so there's, you know the way abortion is illegal in Ireland?
It's illegal.
Illegal, yes, yeah. So today there's a thing called Strike4Repeal, which is basically protesting that. And you see a lot of people wearing black, that's why they're wearing black, but also a lot of the statues around town have either had lightning bolts put on them or have been covered over.
To try to make it legal.
Or, yes, yeah. There's basically been a long-running demand for a constitutional referendum, and the government keeps delaying it, so that's what's going on, basically.
Government.
There'll be protests around the city from about 10:30, and probably about 1 o'clock it's going to get a bit jammed up because there's going to be a big protest out on O'Connor Street Bridge.
I didn't suspect how successful the day was going to prove. Yes, there'd been a first social media buzz, but the national media had completely blanked it. I'd heard that all the colleges were going to have walkouts, but would that translate into only half a dozen activists from each, or more meaningful numbers? The plan I knew was to block O'Connell Street Bridge at 12:30, but would that amount to 100 people being shoved around by the cops, as I'd experienced at Reclaim the Streets in the early 2000s? Or would it be enough people that the cops would have to shrug their shoulders, back off, and wait for everyone to disperse? As I cycled into town, I did notice a lot more people all dressed in black than what I thought was normal, but then again, I'd never before looked for people all in black, so what was normal? The Strike4Repeal organisers had asked people to come all in black, a reference to the Polish women's strike of a few months previously. A few of the people I saw were carrying placards wearing repeal jumpers, so they were definitely on side, but were the rest simply on their way to the office? The idea was ambitious, to try and get a lot of people to take the day off work. It wasn't intended as an actual labour strike, in order to jam up the city with protests. The public meeting back in the autumn had been quite well attended. About 100 people had split into 5 planning groups at it. But I hadn't been involved, and although the couple of WSM members who were there had been positive, it was hard to know if this was simply hopefulness. The left had also not exactly been enthusiastic. At least one prominent left Facebook page hadn't advertised the strike at all, and the main left event was a march after work that evening. But there was a lot of chat on Twitter, so much so that the day before, Strike4Repeal was the number 5 trending topic in Ireland. But would that translate into actual feet on the street? The first statue location, the Mary One on Constitution Hill, had already been restored by the time I cycled past. She had been wearing a Strike4Repeal placard around her neck. Such statues are found all over Ireland, and indeed it was in front of one of these that 15-year-old pregnant schoolgirl Anne Lovett died while secretly giving birth on the 31st of January 1984. The statue of James Joyce across from the GPO was still covered when I got there, Joyce being one of the writers whose books were banned in Ireland and who ended up in self-imposed exile. Constance Markievicz was likewise still covered up. She'd been the most prominent woman leader of the 1916 insurrection, and over the last couple of years she has become something of an icon for the pro-choice movement. Molly Malone, as we've seen, had a Strike4Repeal lightning bolt around her neck. Wolf Tone on College Green had also been covered in the early hours of the morning, but by the time I passed at around 10:15, he'd been uncovered. Markievicz remained covered into the evening. I'd locked my bike beside her and picked that up after the protests. As 10:30 approached, I cycled to the Department of Justice on Stephen's Green. I really didn't expect there to be many people at such an early time. Years before, in 2004, I'd been involved in organising a somewhat similar day of protests, on that occasion leading up to a banned march on an EU summit being held in the Phoenix Park. Very few people had been at our first morning protest, but by the march that evening there were as many as 5,000 on the streets. So as I arrived, I was pleased to see that were already about 30 people present. The organisers had arranged the morning to be a set of rolling pickets of government buildings that led up to everyone heading for the bridge. The picket of the Department of Justice grew as it went on, with at one point about 40 people arriving at it from a feeder march, perhaps from one of the colleges. By the time we were marching to government buildings for the second picket of the morning, numbers had grown to 150 and indeed 200 as some more people met us there at 11 a.m. This was also when the first of the massive Strike4Repeal banners made their appearance, each being as high as a person and about 7 meters in length.
Who are we?
From here it was on to the final picket at the Department of Health. As we marched from Merrion Square around the back of Trinity College, numbers had grown enough to give the march a real atmosphere of something happening that built when we reached Pier Street. The crowd of mostly young women were giving it socks, a lot more energy than your standard Dublin march.
Repurposing a knee holder.
The Department of Health was the first time we had anything approaching speeches. Personally, I find a lot of Dublin protests to be very speech heavy, and all the worse when the speeches are mostly delivered by the same handful of professional left politicians. The pro-choice movement has been quite good in recent years in breaking that mould, particularly the annual March for Choice, where there are multiple speakers, but the selection is around making sure the full range of people impacted by the abortion ban are represented. As such, rather than standing around listening to a string of politicians telling us what we already know with feeling, they provide an educational opportunity that I find quite welcome.
And across the globe, today there are over 50 actions. There are 50 Strike4Repeal actions from Westport to Aberdeen, Cork, Kerry, Galway, Leeds, Montreal, Melbourne, Berlin, New York, France. I can't even name them all. These people are out in solidarity with us and for everyone who has to travel for abortion or has to have illegal abortion in this country. We know that we have support and we know that we will win.
Now it was time for the main event. The crowd at this point was a few hundred strong and it was directed down the narrow lane that opens onto the quays with the Strike4Repeal banner in the lead. As you can see, the banner had to double back on itself as it was about twice the width of the lane. As we reached the quays, other people in position at the junction stepped into the road to direct traffic away so cars would not be trapped by the action. Now there was a little bit of controversy about this policy in the aftermath, with a few people thinking the purpose should have included trapping cars in order to make things more difficult for the cops. Having previously been involved in Reclaim the Streets actions, I reckon this wasn't a well thought out idea though. It has two major problems. Firstly, the individual drivers may well be very pissed off. A parent on the way to pick up kids from school, for instance, is not going to be happy at all if they're actually stuck for a couple of hours. And secondly, our experience from Reclaim the Streets was that some drivers in situations go full road rage and try and force their way through, creating a real danger to participants and an opportunity for cops to wade in on health and safety grounds. In particular, it also has to be said for blockades that involve a lot of people who don't know each other, the organisers have to have an overall agreed plan in advance and implement that plan together. That can be pretty important. In any case, the Strike4Repeal slowly made its way up the quays, and as we approached the bridge, I could hear cheers from what was a fairly large crowd waiting there for us.
We said we won't wait!
Pretty quickly, the march poured onto the eastern side of the bridge, blocking that completely. Feeder marches started to arrive from the college walkouts, and quite quickly, these blocked the western side of the bridge, the southern quays, and then most of the northern quays. Enough space was left to allow cars to escape on the northern quays by turning left onto O'Connell Street, and it's my understanding that it was leaving this escape route open that later caused some of this controversy. However, on the southern side there was a bit of road rage with a van driving into the crowd and nearly hitting someone. An angry woman hit the side of the van with a pan, it screeched to a halt, and the driver got out all ready for some aggro until he was convinced it was smarter to get on his way. A taxi also tried to drive through the crowd, and this ended up stuck in the middle of the bridge for some time as a result. I spent most of the next 30 minutes up a traffic light videoing the growing numbers. More feeder marches arrived, but it was also clear as lunchtime started that a very large number of city workers had popped down. By 1:30, the bridge and the quays were jammed up pretty solid. I have a reputation for doing actual counts on demonstrations, so I had a string of people finding me and asking me how many were present. I couldn't actually do any sort of count, the crowd was too packed in, But at the time, I was making a fairly wild estimate of between 3,000 and 10,000 people being there. Later on that evening, I did use an app to calculate the maximum possible number that could have fitted into the space occupied, and that turned out to be 8,000. It's probable the actual number was lower than that maximum, but certainly we were talking of something like 5,000 people at peak, which is a hell of a lunchtime turnout. If there were any speeches on the bridge, I missed them. You'd have needed a hell of a PA, so if the megaphone was used, it was in another corner and I didn't hear it at all. People filled the time with the light of hyper-energetic chanting and dancing, aided on the eastern side of the bridge by half a dozen drummers, and on the western side by a small PA in a shopping trolley blasting out tunes. As the crowd started to thin at the end of the lunch break, the mostly student core of the demonstration started to march in a big circle around the roadworks that blocked off the centre of the bridge. Around this point, I headed off to get some lunch and to edit and post a quick video report in the hope of encouraging people to come down for the march that evening. International Women's Day, March the 8th, and the continued refusal of the Irish government to introduce a referendum to remove the hated Eighth Amendment results in an enormous mobilisation, peaking at lunchtime, blocking off O'Connell Street Bridge. Today's enormous and militant protest was called under the title of Strike4Repeal. The purpose is to try and force the government to immediately introduce a referendum to get rid of the Eighth Amendment. This amendment, passed in 1983, makes it illegal for abortion to be carried out in Ireland under almost all circumstances. It was passed at the last moment where Ireland had, where the Irish Catholic Church still had a strong influence. Ever since those years, it's faded. And most people today, including most young people, want to get rid of the referendum. It was notable in the run-up to today's protest that although it had been covered in the international press and some local media, there had been no coverage in national media. The Irish Times, RTE and The Independent had all failed to cover it, and that very much reflects the way secure journalists in Ireland are part and parcel of the establishment. They don't rock the boat very much at all, and their big concern in terms of the campaign to repeal the Eighth Amendment has been that it's too militant and, I dare say, too young. No doubt the complete disruption of traffic in the city centre will mean journalists were being rushed to the scene, and we'll see some coverage of today's events on the evening news. But it's important to understand that that section of the media is really not on our side. Instead, today's mobilisation was overwhelmingly built through existing contacts between radicals and through social media. Yesterday on Twitter, for instance, the Strike4Repeal hashtag was trending at number 5 position in Ireland, and the same again this morning. As such, the large turnout and the militant action of blocking the bridge again illustrates that the day when the mainstream media could tightly control the narrative and limit it to within very narrow margins of debate has long since passed, and that it can be overcome at times where people are really pissed off, and they're certainly really pissed off right now. They want change, they demand change. Official Ireland and its rigid hierarchies that came into existence with independence is rotting from the inside out. Last weekend, there was confirmation that in the mother and child home in Tuam, almost 800 babies had indeed been buried in a septic tank out the back, almost in complete secrecy. These homes were run by the Catholic Church, but this was in complete cooperation with the Irish state, and indeed, the Garda would often pick up and return women who had escaped from them, despite the fact that actually there was no legal process whatsoever that they were entitled to do this under. It was all part of controlling the general population and imposing a very rigid hierarchy on them. In today's Ireland, we're fed up with this system. We want change, and we want it now. The question is how to get there. Today provided an answer to that.
Today's event was organised completely horizontally by a network of activists, not by a political party, and indeed most of the political parties did very little to advertise it in advance of the event happening. We don't need another top-down hierarchy to try and sort things out for us. We need to take power ourselves and work together to transform the society we live in.
While doing this, I missed the standoff with a small mob of anti-choicers who turned up at the Central Bank Plaza with a van-mounted ad, "They've money to burn as usual," and giant printed gory banners, "Yet more money to burn." Apparently one of the huge Strike4Repeal banners was walked over to their small block and used to obscure their banner, and after a while they slunk off as the crowd sung, "We are the champions." I very much regret not getting that on video. The same small group turned up at the door later on after the march that evening, where Ferdia reported that banners from non-binary Ireland were rapidly used to screen them off. This is his footage. At 1700, I headed up to Parnell Square, where the more traditional wing of the pro-choice movement had called an after-work speeches and march event. This had been timetabled for International Women's Day without realising perhaps the massive mobilising effect that Strike4Repeal was going to play. They'd clearly expected a very much smaller crowd than what turned out, and the indication of that was the PA they had was suitable for a demonstration of perhaps 1,000 or so. Probably in the region of 11,000 people showed up, with the result that there was a lot of standing around as the scheduled speeches were made in the corner to the small segment of the crowd actually able to hear that PA. Fortunately, the weather was good, so everyone else was happy enough to stand around and chat while the speeches were completed. This crowd was enormous. Before 5:30, it had already spilled out of the corner of the Garden of Remembrance and around onto Parnell Square North. By 6 o'clock or so, it had almost filled Parnell Square North and a good chunk of Parnell Square East as well. The video of the march departing the square that I'll play here gives some idea of just how many people had come along. I spent some time photographing and video recording the march before finally being able to fall in with the sizeable anarchist block as it reached the GPO. The post-dusk light at this moment was great for atmospheric photography, further aided by the triggering of some purple smoke flares as we made our way across O'Connell Bridge and then past the front gates of TCD. The anarchist block was at the start of the last quarter of the march, and by the time we were making our way down Nassau Street, we were passing and being greeted by people who had been nearer the front and were now heading home. The march filled Kildare Street all the way from the door back down to the intersection with Nassau Street, and people were pretty tightly packed in. I calculated afterwards that the maximum capacity of that area was 11,000 people. The actual attendance was probably a little bit higher than this, as some people wouldn't have completed the entire route, and as above, some people were leaving while we were still a few minutes from the endpoint. Overall, Strike4Repeal Day can be called a huge success, in particular given the very limited resources available to build it. How limited those were, and indeed how asymmetrical the struggle is on these terms, is illustrated by the fact that the cost of the anti-choice ad mounted on the van was almost certainly greater than the entire Strike4Repeal budget. The largest negative, but not an unexpected one, was the way the national media decided to refuse to cover the event, both in the days beforehand, and really on the day itself as well, until the blockage of O'Connell Street Bridge forced them to admit it was happening. RTÉ were left scrambling for footage for the evening news and reduced to broadcasting some from the CCTV cameras that overlook O'Connell Bridge. The Irish Times were forced to admit its initial claim that only a few hundred people were taking part was rubbish and updated that to thousands. This is all the more reason to put together our own footage and our own account of what happened to refer back to in future.